Hi everyone, and welcome to our online service of worship for today, Sunday, the 4th of October. Now hopefully, most of our churches will be open for worship for the first time today since lockdown began back in March. But equally, there will be some members of our congregations who feel less than comfortable going back into a form of public worship that will be very different from what we have been used to. I have therefore decided to continue for the present time at least to offer the online and printed services for those who are interested, including audio CDs for those who have requested them. Our focus for today, again, is going to be on the set New Testament reading, which is taken from chapter 3 of Paul's letter to the church in Philippi. Today, Paul was reflecting on having reason to put confidence in the flesh, but he concludes that whatever he previously considered as gain should be regarded as loss, especially when he compares it to the righteousness we gain from God through having faith in our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. But as always, however you are engaging with our service today, via Facebook or YouTube, hard copy or audio CD, my prayer is that we will all strive to attain the ultimate goal, the ultimate prize that Paul refers to, that can only be found through being called heavenward in Jesus Christ. Our call to worship. God calls us all on a journey. That journey is the journey of life. God calls us to set our sights on the goal that he wants us to achieve. That goal can only be reached by following and living in the way of Christ. Come, right now, to offer all that you have and all that you are in order to reach that goal and to honour the name above all names. Let's pray together. Lord God, as we journey towards the goal you set before us, we see glimpses of who you are, often too deep and unimaginable to fully grasp the depth of your being. What we see and what we feel spurs us on in our journey to discover more and more of you. Be with us now, we pray, as we offer this time of worship and praise to your glory, and help us to remain faithful to you in all that we do, as we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In chapter 3 of his letter to the church in Philippi, Paul is reflecting on all that he managed to achieve before his conversion experience, and the fact that, just like all those he's writing to, whatever he once considered to be gain, he now considers loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ as his Lord. He considers his ultimate success to be entirely dependent on striving towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called him heavenward in Christ Jesus. Our points are therefore going to be succeeding through looking ahead, succeeding through being passionate, and succeeding through knowing what matters and not giving up. But first, we reflect on the fact that God in Christ calls our name and receives us as his own, setting us free in order to experience life in all its fullness by walking with Jesus. We sing together, "Great God, your love has called us here."
This will be made known.
Come now to our prayers of praise and confession. Let's pray together. Lord God, we are all so different, each our own being, and yet you love us and care for us individually, nurturing and protecting us from all danger. How can we not be thankful to you for all that the journey with you offers? We thank you that you guide us in unexpected ways to find the right way in life. We thank you that whenever we wander, you draw us back to you, giving us new direction and encouraging us to follow where you lead. We thank you that you know our individual needs and quirks, and that you yearn for us to be on the journey of life with you. We thank you that the pains of life can be overshadowed by the joy of walking with you. For all these blessings and more, we give you our thanks and our praise. However, God of the journey of life, the mystery of our very being, we confess that the journey we take gets disrupted at times, and we often get sidetracked along our way of following you. We sometimes go off on wild goose chases that lead us nowhere, up blind alleys and into unhealthy and barren places. We find our way back to you in sorrow for our failings and in penitence for our wrongdoings. May we be enriched by your welcome, relieved by your forgiveness, and comforted by your all-embracing love. For we praise your holy name, that through the blood of Jesus, we are forgiven time and time again, regardless of how undeserving we are. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving each one of us. Amen. We focus on our desire to grow in faith and in holiness now as we ask God to purify our hearts so that we may fulfill our goal of being holy and set apart in order to accomplish the will of God. We sing together, "Purify my heart, let it be as gold and precious silver."
Purify my heart, let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart, let me be as gold, pure gold, refined as fire. My heart's one desire is to be from within and make me holy. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin. Deep within, be fire's fire. My heart's one desire is to do your will.
We listen now to our reading from Philippians chapter 3.
Philippians chapter 3. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness, based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of His resurrection and participation in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenwards in Christ Jesus.
As we reflect on the reading that we've just heard, we focus particularly on the fact that God is the only inheritance that any of us really need. We sing together, "Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart." we first look at this reading from Paul's letter to the church in Philippi, it almost seems like Paul is boasting about his achievements. But in fact, when we look in more detail, it's clear that the very opposite is the case. He is acknowledging that, no matter how impressive our human attainments may seem, they cannot earn us salvation and eternal life with God. And Paul certainly did have very impressive credentials indeed, through his upbringing, through his nationality, through his family background, through his inheritance, his orthodoxy, and his activity. However, Paul's conversion to faith in Christ, that we read about in Acts chapter 9, wasn't based on what he had done in the past, but entirely on the extravagant grace of God. Paul belonged to the tribe of Benjamin, a heritage that was greatly esteemed among the Jews. He was also, as I'm sure we know, a Pharisee, a member of a very devout Jewish sect. Pharisees scrupulously kept not only the laws of Moses, but also numerous rules of their own, and this would have held him in very high esteem indeed. But the question is, why did Paul, a devout Jewish leader, persecute the church? Well, he would have agreed with the leaders of the religious establishment, who thought that Christianity was heretical and blasphemous. This is because Jesus certainly did not meet their expectations of what the Messiah ought to be like. And Paul was in agreement that Jesus' claims, therefore, had to be false and wicked. Additionally, he saw Christianity as a political menace, because it threatened to disrupt the fragile harmony between the Jews and the Roman government. But after his conversion, Paul realized that no amount of law-keeping, no amount of self-improvement, no amount of discipline, no amount of religious effort can make us right with God. Righteousness comes from God and can only be attained by trusting in Christ. Paul had good reason to want to forget what he had left behind him. After all, he held the coats of those who stoned Stephen, the first Christian martyr, as we read in Acts chapter 7. And if we're honest, we have all done things that we're not particularly proud of at certain times in our lives. And many of us live in the tension of what we have been in the past and what we would like to be in the future. However, because our hope is in Christ and in Christ alone, we should be able to let go of any guilt from the past and instead look forward to what God is planning for the future. We mustn't dwell on the past, but instead grow in the knowledge of God through a life of faith and obedience, looking towards the fuller and more meaningful life through the hope that we have in Jesus Christ our Lord. Our points for today are therefore succeeding through looking ahead, succeeding through being passionate, and succeeding by knowing what matters and not giving up. In Psalm 119, the psalmist wrote, "Open my eyes that I may see." And actually, in order to succeed in life, we need to do several things that are summarized by our first point, which is succeeding through looking ahead. The first thing we need to do when looking ahead is to refuse to settle for yesterday's accomplishments. If what we did yesterday still looks big to us today, probably we haven't done enough today. Paul celebrated his accomplishments, but he focused on what God had for him in the future, as we read in verses 13 and 14 of the reading that we're looking at. Forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead, I press on. Next, we need to refuse to sit around waiting for tomorrow's opportunities. Between the great things we cannot do and the little things we will not do, the danger is that we will do nothing at all. The world is blessed most by those who do things, not by those who merely talk about doing things. We also need to refuse to let our beginning dictate our end. Agricultural scientist and inventor George Washington Carver spent his early years being shuffled between foster homes until, it is thought, Maria Watkins, a washerwoman, found him asleep in her barn. She didn't just take him in, she took him to church and introduced him to Jesus. When he eventually left her home, he took with him the Bible she'd given him. Maria left a mark on his life, and George left a mark on the world. George, who is known as the father of modern agriculture, was a friend to three presidents, as well as Henry Ford and Mahatma Gandhi. He is credited with over 300 different inventions, and the remarkable thing is, despite his disadvantages, he never became bitter or spent so much as a moment getting even. Instead, he went into his lab every morning and prayed, "Open my eyes that I may see." How could God fail to bless someone with such an attitude? Point one is succeeding through looking ahead. Our second point is inspired by Paul's words when he said, "I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Succeeding through being passionate. Albert Schweitzer, who was a doctor, a missionary, a philosopher, and a musician, said, "Success is not the key to happiness. Happiness is the key to success. If we love what we are doing, we will be successful." When we feel passionate about something and allow ourselves to pursue it, we position ourselves to succeed in life. The majority of people in the world don't follow their passion. As a result, they become frustrated and unhappy. And we can clearly see it in how they live their lives. Publisher Malcolm Forbes said, "The biggest mistake people make in life is not trying to make a living at what they enjoy. As a result, they simply endure their working lives instead of making the most of them. They live for the weekends. They try to hang on until retirement. And that's a great shame, because our chances of success are directly proportionate to the degree of pleasure we derive from what we do." Manager of the Los Angeles Dodgers baseball team, Tommy Lasorda, said, "The best day of my life is when I manage a winning game, and the second best day of my life is when I manage a losing game." In other words, every day he was involved in the game was a day he was living his dream. I wonder how many of us can say the same. Our dreams come true when our gifts are set on fire with passion. The best career advice we will ever receive is to discover our God-given passion and follow it. Logan Pearsall Smith was an American-born British essayist and critic who was Harvard and Oxford educated. He famously said, "There are two things to aim at in life. First, to get what you want, and after that, to enjoy it. Only the wisest of mankind achieve the second." So, in Paul's words, we need to press towards the goal for the prize. Point two is succeeding through being passionate. Our third and final point is succeeding by knowing what matters and not giving up. Paul knew that there really was only one thing that mattered to him, and that was forgetting what was behind and straining towards what is ahead. Howard Hendricks was a professor of theology who taught Bible exposition and hermeneutics, and he also mentored hundreds of pastors and leaders. He writes, "As a young leader, my biggest mistake was allowing my time to be eaten up with things outside my core competencies. I wanted to set the pace for others, to demonstrate that nothing was beneath me. Therefore, I devoted an inordinate amount of time to things I wasn't good at, things I would never be good at. At the same time, I invested very little energy into developing my strengths. Finally, I realized that my true value lay within the context of my giftedness, not in the number of hours I worked. There were some balls I had no business juggling. When I finally got the courage to let them fall to the floor, I began to excel in juggling the two or three balls I was created to keep in the air in the first place. And the amazing thing is, people came along and picked up the other balls. What I couldn't relinquish were the opportunities they had been waiting for." So maybe we all need to ask ourselves, of the two or three things that define success for us, which of them are in line with our core competencies? That is where we need to focus our energies. That is where we will excel. Within that narrow context, we make our greatest contribution. And best of all, we will enjoy what we do. Now, some may say, but I can't afford to focus all my energies on one or two things. Well, maybe not yet, but that should be our goal. It's something we should be working towards if we want to succeed where it matters most. Paul was driven by his vision of reaching the world for Christ, as we read in Romans chapter 10. It was his yardstick for daily living and his motivation for every effort. It made him relentless. An unknown poet once wrote, "When things go wrong, as they sometimes will, and the road you're trudging seems all uphill, when funds are low and the debts are high, and you want to smile, but you have to sigh, when things are pressing you down a bit, rest if you must, but do not quit. Life is strange with its twists and turns, as every one of us sometimes learns. And many a failure turns about when we might have won if we'd stuck it out. Don't give up, though the pace seems slow. You might succeed with another blow. Often the stranger has given up when he might have captured the victor's cup. And he learned too late when the knight slipped down how close he was to the golden crown. Success is failure turned upside down, the silver tint of the clouds of doubt. You never can tell how close you are. It may be near when it seems afar. So stick to the fight when you're hardest hit. It's when things seem worse that you mustn't quit." Point three is succeeding by knowing what matters and not giving up. So to recap, Paul didn't see success as being something that he could achieve on his own merits, but something that could only be achieved entirely through the extravagant grace of God. Our points are therefore succeeding through looking ahead, succeeding through being passionate, and succeeding by knowing what matters and not giving up. All to the glory of the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. One of the most powerful things I took from the reading that we're looking at is when Paul says, "But whatever were gains to me now, I consider loss for the sake of Christ." As we ponder, we sing together, "When I survey the wondrous cross."
I pray.
We come now to our prayers of intercession. Let's pray together. God of one and God of all, we come to you now, and as we do, we pray for those who do not know who they are, for those who cannot understand themselves or their place within society. God of all, we pray for them. We hold before you all those known and unknown who simply do not fit in, those who are or who seem in various ways to be different. God of all, we pray for them. We pray for those who genuinely do not know where they come from, their heritage or home, their family or bloodline. God of all, we pray for them. We bring to you those who feel lost and isolated, those who are confused and afraid, those who feel that they are rudderless or homeless, for strangers in a strange land. God of all, we pray for them. We pray also for those who wish they were somewhere else or someone else, in some other time and place. God of all, we pray for them. In your great mercy, Lord, hear our prayers and grant safe passage and sure journeys for them all, as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And we bring all of our prayers together by joining in the words of the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Paul says in the reading that we've been looking at today, I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. I wonder if Charles Wesley was inspired by these words following his conversion. We ponder that thought as we sing together, and can it be that I should gain an interest in the Saviour's blood?
Thank you.
Almighty God, we are all on a journey, the journey of our Christian lives. Its foundations full of all that has gone before are part of the scaffold of our lives. Some of it can be seen by others, some only by ourselves. Some is very obvious, some more hidden. But it is there. It is a personal journey. No one else's is quite the same. But you know it, and you know all of us. And we trust you to guide us, to give us the strength, the courage, and the persistence that we need to follow where you lead, even if the path is tough. Be our guide, we pray. And as we leave this time of worship and praise, may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with each one of us, all those we love, and all those we hold in our hearts and in our prayers, both this day and forevermore. Amen.